I was off this snafu, but I'm going to try to catch up with the lecture. I finished last time with very briefly talking about mutations. Now I'm going to develop it a little more. We're going to talk about two main things today. First, a short part about what mutations are, very relatively briefly. And the second part is about Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. This is the beginning of understanding what microevolution is. In evolution, you have two major ways of looking at things. Microevolution, what happens to individual populations at a very, very small scale, spatial and temporal scale. And then macroevolution, that is why do you have elephants and seahorses, big things. So today we're going to talk about microevolution. So it's just the nitty-gritty, it's just the math behind how exactly evolution works. Before we go into that, I will talk a little bit about mutations, and there are a lot of different aspects of it. It's important, of course, because it's really the fundamentals of what the material, the raw material that evolution works with, but the reality of it is that there isn't all that much to talk about. I mean, it can be immensely complex, it's fun and interesting, but the concepts are actually relatively simple, so I will not spend that much time on it. Mutations are what happens when DNA is modified. So, I said it last time, the most classic example of that is before I do all this, we had there, yesterday we were on the plane, Dan Ray and I, and the person that was sitting next to me is this physician in Santa Cruz, I don't know her, and she dared me that I would make you guys do some yoga early before we start the class, but because we are so late, we can't do the yoga, I'm really sorry. So we lost the bet. Anyway, so this is what happens in mutations. So, there is UV light, this is one example of mutation. UV light, you are not putting too much sunscreen on, you are out in the sun. UV light is binding two consecutive T's that are on the same strand of the DNA. It's called a thymidine dimer. And because they are bound to each other, and not to the ones that are across on the other helix, which would be the two A's, they are going to be a problem during the replication phase. When the DNA is going to be opened up and replicated, the DNA replicase will have, the polymerase will have a hard time, actually will not be able to take one T and then the next one, it will not recognize this bound dimer and will insert a mutation on the other strand. And that's how the mutation is propagated. However, this really is not what happens. Most of the time, the DNA is actually repaired. And you have a series of enzymes that are specifically designed to repair DNA because mutations occur at a certain frequency, which importantly, we don't know what that frequency is. However, at a certain frequency, DNA is repaired and then everything is good. However, in some cases, because there are so many mutations, the repair machinery does not fix the mutation as when you are getting old, for example, there is less of repair or it just happens. And in this case, the mutation is kept in the individual, and this is what is visible. Now, what I want to say is that there is a nomenclature issue, and I mentioned it last time as well. What happens at the level of DNA is called a mutation. And there's a bunch of them, and these are mostly fixed. And when they are not fixed, they are called substitutions. Because we are lazy, we just call them mutations. But the reality of it is that they are not really mutations. They are a subset of the original mutations. And so in order to separate semantically the two types of things, some are called mutations. This is really what happens to DNA. And then when they are not fixed, they are called substitutions. Unfortunately, and we will see that in just a few minutes, there is another thing that is completely different that happens to also be called substitutions. So for the same word describes two completely different things. I'm really sorry about that, that's just the way it is. So because of that, people use mutations just not to confuse the other type of substitutions. Very early on, two scientists, really one, Elin Zuckerkandel, but Linus Pauling, who used to live in Zwickau and had two Nobel Prizes, they wrote a very important paper in 1965 that was a paper about molecular clocks. Their idea seemed very simple, yet at that time no one had thought about that in those terms. And the idea is that if mutations occur, then the further away in time two organisms are, the more mutations separate them. And because of that, you can make what are called molecular clocks. Molecular clocks is what happens when molecular clock, without an S at the end. The idea is that this is the time of separation between organisms and on the various points on those lines, you will have pairs of organisms. If you take a human and a chimp, we have been separated for only 6 million years. But if you take a human and an elephant, it's about 100 million years. And then if you take a jellyfish and a sponge, that's going to be even more time. And so as the time between organisms increases, then the number of mutations that separate them is going to increase. If this is the case, then you will be able to draw a line, and then you can back calculate things that you don't know anything about. So if you're wondering, what is the difference, what is the time of divergence between a horse and a zebra? Well, you can just look at their DNA sequences, look at how many mutations there are, you place them on the line, and then you will be able to determine how long ago they separated. This is what is the use of what is called a molecular clock. When they did that, DNA sequencing was not yet invented. It was invented by Fred Sandler. He got a Nobel Prize for doing DNA sequencing. At that time, only proteins could be sequenced, and Fred Sandler actually invented how to sequence proteins, and he got a second Nobel Prize for it. And they took some globins, which are like parts of hemoglobin, and they looked at their divergence, and that they made this blue line in the middle over there. So I won't talk about the other lines for now, because it's going to come in just a few minutes. But the idea is relatively simple. You have mutations, it separates organisms in time, and the more time there is, the more mutations there are. That is just as simple as that. Mutations themselves, not substitutions, but mutations, are actually not equal in frequency. We mentioned that there are two types of mutations, transitions and transversions. And this is for chemical reasons and physical reasons. When you have two rings in the bases or a single ring in the base, it's going to take a different type of space. And also, the hydrogen bonds that you're going to make with the other strand are going to be different. And so because of that, actually chemically, the mutations do not occur at the same pace. Transitions, which change purines into purines or pyrimidines into pyrimidines, occur more frequently than transversions, which change a purine into a pyrimidine or the reverse. Because the type of molecules that you're changing are actually different. So the frequency of those is different. And so because of that, substitution models have also been modified. Original, the Drew-Scanter model, is a model that assumes that the frequency of any mutation is the same, alpha, and instead in the Kimura 2 parameter model, you have a difference in frequency of mutation between a transition and a transversion. Transition is alpha and transversion is beta. I talked a lot about this before, but I'm placing that into the context of mutations. Now let's look at something slightly different. Two other cases that I find very interesting and are going to question what I just talked about. The first one is an example. Cytochrome D, it's a protein that is found in mitochondria, and it's a protein that is involved in respiration. Our mitochondria are producing ATP. The way they work, they produce ATP is by capturing oxygen and then eventually producing energy and then ATP. The protein is a transmembrane protein. It means that the protein itself goes through the membrane of the mitochondria. The membrane is represented here by this bilayer right over there, this sort of yellowish thing. And the protein is the garbled stuff that is in between. So you have a part of the protein that is inside the mitochondria, a part that is outside of the mitochondria, and there is a part that is interacting with the membrane. The part that is interacting with the membrane that is in the middle, this part here, is very constrained. It's very constrained because each amino acid needs to interact with the membrane for the protein to be placed correctly. The selective pressure of the three different regions of the protein is going to be very different. When you are on the top and on the bottom, you can change some amino acids, and most of the time the protein is still going to work. When you are inside the membrane, there is going to be a very strong interaction between the membrane and the protein, and most changes are going to prevent the protein from sitting properly on the membrane. And so the selective pressure is going to be very strong. The result of that is that if you are sequencing many individuals, and you are sequencing their cytochrome Bs, and you plot where the mutations are, you will realize that there are actually hot spots of mutations. And these are represented here, where some regions don't have very many mutations, and others have a lot of them. What is the proper interpretation of this? Does anyone have any idea of what this means? What happened? Go ahead.
When mutations occur in the membrane-expanding regions, it can't function, so it doesn't get passed on because that individual can't continue reproducing and can't do its job.
You're right. And so, how does it work? So what are we looking at here? Are we looking at mutations?
Frequency of mutations?
No. You're right. All what you said is right. And I sort of tricked you in calling them mutations because I was lazy. But what we're looking at here are substitutions. Because mutations, when the DNA is replicated, the machinery that has no idea if it's inside an inside a region that is binding or not. And so mutations occur randomly through the genome. And so you have to imagine that the number of mutations are exactly the same everywhere on average. Yet, what we are observing is that in some very important regions, we don't see those mutations. So clearly what you said is exactly right. Organisms that have this kind of stuff are dead. And so we don't see them. So what we're looking at here is not mutations, it's substitutions. And that's where it becomes a little bit more than semantic. It's really, and this is why it's so difficult to estimate how many mutations exist, because probably, so these ones you see that there's a lot of substitutions, but actually there probably were way more, and those ones have been actually fixed by the cleaning machinery of the genome. And so there used to be even more than that, but this is what has been essentially allowed to remain in the genome. And then the other things is that the organisms are there. So that's what one of the really cool things, a German engineer during the Second World War was able to increase the efficiency of their planes. What they did is that every time that planes would come back from dogfights, they would actually plot all the bullet holes all over the planes, and then they looked at, they mapped them, and there were regions in the planes where there were no bullet holes, and so they reinforced those regions, because those ones that were not coming back, that had bullet holes there, were actually dead. That's exactly the same idea. The idea is that you have regions that are without any mutations. This is where there used to be a lot of mutations and all these organisms are dead. It's exactly the same idea. So this is a good illustration of the difference between mutations and substitutions. The genetic code, unlike what they say when you are listening to the TV and they say, oh, we just sequence the genome code of a human, which is ridiculous. The genetic code is a dictionary that is translating DNA into amino acids. That's what the genetic code is. There are many genetic codes. The more common one that we tend to be interested in is the genetic code that translates nuclear DNA of vertebrates into amino acids. However, mitochondria have a slightly different genetic code, and so are some microorganisms. But the more common one is the one that I'm presenting here. It seems really simple, but it is very, very complex. In the genetic code, three nucleotides are translated into a single amino acid. There are 64 codons, because 3 to the power of 4 is 64, and there are only 20 amino acids. Because of that, a lot of those codons are redundant. And the way they are redundant is absolutely fabulous. You should spend hours and hours looking at the genetic code, and the more you stare at it, and the more you will realize how incredibly cool life is. Because the evolution of the genetic code is absolutely fascinating. But in general, we consider that there are three main types of codons. There is one type that has four codons that encode for a single amino acid. When this happens, it's always the third codon position that changes. It's called the wobble position. The wobble position sometimes is called four-fold degenerate position.
I don't know if this is it visible, this color sucks.
The third codon position can vary, the first two can't. This means that if you have a mutation in the third codon position, the amino acid is not going to change. The genotype will change, the phenotype will not change. Then there is another group of amino acids that is encoded by two codons. Like, for example, these guys. And in this case, the third codon position is there are two potential nucleotides. In all cases, these are transitions. They are never transversions. And then there is a third one that is really rare, is that there are two of them only, methionine, I think there is one other one, that, maybe it's only methionine, that is encoded by a single codon. Methionine, incidentally, is the first amino acid of all the proteins, I'm not sure you're aware of that. And then there are three codons that encode for stop, which is OCR, AMPR, and OPO, and they are the ones that are in red. Finally, there is another category that's a little bit special, that is amino acids that are encoded by six codons, and those six codons, it's a regular four codon plus two, and the difference between the four and the two is that the first codon position can be variable. That's the case of serine. Very good. You can see it better than me. The ones that are, there we go, you're right. Serine over there and serine here. And so you see that the, in this case, the first codon position can change in these cases. Now, if you look at the frequency of mutations, which is the frequency of substitutions in the genome, the highest frequency that is observed is always in third codon position. Then it's in first codon position, and finally it's in second codon position. Every time you change a second codon position, every time, you are going to change the amino acid. There is no wobble in second codon position. In first codon position, in some cases you can change it without changing the amino acid. In third codon position, if you have a transition, you can almost always not change the amino acid. If you have a transversion, sometimes you may not change the amino acid. And what I mean by that is we are in this situation here. If you were to look at a regular protein, you have big peaks at third codon position, medium peaks at first, and hardly any at second. Mutations occurred everywhere at the same frequency. However, what you observe eventually is a lot of mutations in third codon position and then slightly less in the other ones. This brings me back to this. I mean, this is kind of for the nerds that are paying attention. The reason why you have different slopes in different proteins is because selective pressure on different proteins is different, and so the number of substitutions that you're going to observe on average is going to be different depending on how much selective pressure you have on the different proteins. If you got this, great. If you didn't, it's not that important. Okay, now I need to switch to, unfortunately, another term for substitution. So, because here you are going to have two types of mutations, substitutions, should I say. Some mutations are not going to change the amino acid, which are mostly in third codon position. However, some mutations, for example, the mutations in second codon position, are always going to change the amino acid. You actually are going to have a ratio between mutations that are changing the amino acid or not. And depending on how much selection there is on the protein, the ratio is going to change. You can change a lot of amino acids if the protein is not doing all that much, and in which case you will have a lot of second codon position changes. Or maybe there is every single amino acid counts, and then you will have hardly any changes in second codon position. And this is what is called synonymous versus non-synonymous substitutions. And in this case, substitutions are referring to, are you going to change or not the amino acid? If you are not changing the amino acid, it is called a synonymous substitution. If you change the amino acid, it's going to be called a non-synonymous substitution. And to make things more complicated, some people say that when you don't change the amino acid, you call it a mutation, and when you change an amino acid, you just call it a substitution. So you really need to understand the context of what people are talking about to fully understand what they're talking about. This is a bit of a mess. And I'm going to try to keep it as clear as possible. So synonymous substitutions versus non-synonymous substitutions. If we go back to this, for example here, if there is a mutation from a T to a C, this would be called a synonymous substitution because it does not change the amino acid. If I change the T into an A, it goes from GTT to GAT, so it goes from aspartic acid here, GAT for example, and so this would be a non-synonymous substitution. That is, a mutation has changed the T into an A, it's the second codon position, you change the amino acid. And so the ratio between those two is actually an indication of selection. If the ratio is high, meaning that you are changing a lot of amino acids, there might be a lot of selection. If you don't change very many amino acids, there is not much selection. That's why here the ratio Ka over Ks, Ka is synonymous substitution, Ks is non-synonymous substitutions, it's an indicator of selection. Okay, so that is for what I have to say about point mutations. Now we're going to talk about just larger scale mutations that actually do play an important role, especially in macroevolution. I'm going to go pretty quickly over these because I would like to really talk quite a bit about Hardy-1 drug equilibrium. But all what I talked about so far is what is called point mutations, which is mutations that change a single nucleotide. When it changes a single nucleotide, it's called a point mutation. Copy number mutations change chunks of DNA and it makes different numbers. We're going to talk about it hopefully in a second. Chromosomal mutations, genome mutations, we're going to talk about as well. Let's see. Okay. It doesn't talk about copy number mutations. This is going to be really quick. This could be CACAT and CACAT, for example. These are blocks of sequences, and in this case, there are just two copies. Very often, when the polymerase is replicating the DNA, it actually has a hard time keeping it straight. Right here, there's only two copies, that's easy enough, but if you have 30 copies, for a number of reasons due to secondary conformation of the DNA polymerase has a hard time keeping it straight. And so you have changes in number of what are called number of repeats. These are called copy number mutations. And the frequency of copy number mutations is about the same frequency as a single mutation. And so this one, it would be 2, and then at the next replication, it could put 3 or 4 or 5 blocks like this, and so here it would be 3. And each of us, because these mutations occur rather quickly and they are really easy to detect, each of us have unique numbers of these kind of mutations. And you know, when you hear people that do DNA fingerprinting for forensic analysis, I'm sure that there are TV shows where people do that. I don't watch those things, but I'm sure that they do it. They say, oh, this guy, they take a piece of blood on the ground or something like that. That's what they do. They look at this kind of repeat, and then they can do the fingerprint. DNA fingerprinting is just counting the number of copies of these kind of mutations. It's unique. Paternity analysis. What did I just read? Oh, this morning, I read this news. A guy... There was a lady that was in the hospital and they impregnated her and they just found it, they just DNA fingerprinted. Anyway, copy number mutations. Chromosomal inversions, these are big, we're talking about large mutations. Chromosomal mutations is when you have chromosomal changes, big chunks of chromosomes are broken up and reattached somewhere else. In general, it's not a big deal unless where the chromosome is broken, you have either a gene that is split, then obviously the gene is not going to work, or more commonly, a promoter, which is a thing that tends to make the gene get expressed very quickly, the promoter is moved to a different region. And this happens in a number of cancers. For example, there is a type of a disease that is called Burkitt's lymphoma. That's the case where a promoter of one chromosome is transferred to another chromosome and promotes the expression of a gene that gives you a disease. There is a number of cancers that work exactly that way. So these are very large modifications of the genome. So it is a type of mutation, but I mean, it's just a very, very large scale thing. Changes of chromosome numbers are common. They break and then they fuse together, and so you have very large numbers of very large changes in chromosome numbers, even in closely related individuals. For example, there are small antelope that are called munjaks, very, very closely related species. One has 23 chromosomes, the other one has 4, because the chromosomes, evolutionarily speaking, the chromosomes of this one have fused into very large chromosomes in munjaks, for example. Or you have polyploidization events, where it's very common in plants, where you have plants that fuse their genomes and eventually turn into either polyploid plants. They start at 2N, they grow into 4N, and in some cases, they actually create from 2N to 3N, to 6N, to 4N, and they actually create different species. We will have a lecture on speciation, and in plants, speciation, which means creating new species via polyploidization, is actually a relatively common thing. In animals, it's a lot less common, but in plants, it's a very common mode of speciation. So these are very large scale types of mutations. I find them significant, but to be completely honest, I find them slightly less interesting because, okay, you're making a new chromosome. I mean, that's huge, but there's nothing else to it. When you're looking at point mutations, you have an infinite number of possibilities in how you're going to modulate genes and things like that. So I find it more interesting in some respects. Now, if you look at the evolution of life on Earth, we have a certain number of genes. In humans, we have about 25,000 genes. In most vertebrates, about 25,000. It's a good sort of round number. Genes can evolve in different ways. And this is two examples. Of course, it's fish. But actually, they are kind of cool animals. The top one is an Antarctic fish. It's, some people call it a toothfish or a Chilean sea bass. The bottom one is Arctic cod. So one is in the southern hemisphere, the other one is the northern hemisphere. Both of them deal with water that is colder than the freezing temperature of a fish. They are -2 Celsius, and so they need to deal with it, and the way they did it is that they evolved antifreeze proteins. What is interesting about the system is that the antifreeze proteins of those two species look very, very similar. However, the way the genes evolve is completely different and gives a good illustration of how you can create new genes. These are animals that were not, evolutionarily speaking, always in cold water. These are cooler water species that eventually invaded either the Antarctic or the Arctic. And the way they did it is differently. In the case of the Sausicus, the top one, there are some genes that are not used by those fishes, they're called lectins, and those genes, not being used, are free to evolve and to change into different things, and those genes eventually, after a lot of mutations, started to give a benefit to these fishes as far as antifreeze is concerned, and eventually they turn into antifreeze proteins. The bottom fish instead is completely different. It's not, they didn't take an old gene that they remodeled. Instead, they started from scratch. A large majority of the genome is non-coding. It means that the majority of the genome does not encode for genes, for proteins, and out of intergenic regions, there were mutations that eventually turned into some peptides, and eventually those peptides slowly evolved into proteins. So it's a de novo gene out of nothing. One is a remodel of an old gene, the other one is a gene that comes out of an intergenic region. You know, in an intergenic region, you need first to have an ATG, which is the methionine, that's the beginning. And then you need to have what is called an open reading frame. You need to be able to read something that doesn't have any stop codons. On average, you don't have a stop codon for about 100 nucleotides. And so that's a small protein. But then if you don't have, just randomly, you may not have a stop codon for another 200 or 300 or 400 nucleotides. And so the translation machinery is always trying to make proteins and see what happens. And usually those proteins are discarded. They don't encode for anything. But some of them encode for some types of protein. And eventually it starts to have a function and eventually increases the fitness and turns into a gene. Okay. We're going to take a 1 minute break because we're going to do something that is completely different. This is Hardy Weinberg. So clear your brain for one minute and then we're going to do a Hardy Weinberg. Independently, a little bit like Wallace and Darwin, separately, they worked on those things. Hardy was British, Weinberg was German, but they worked on the same thing. There was no real competition or anything, they just happened to discover it at the same time. There was another person, anyway, we'll talk about it in a second. So the idea is that Gregor Mendel has done some work on peas. There are some frequencies of the various types of peas and the phenotypes, you know, rough peas, yellow ones, green ones, and so on and so forth. You probably heard about the story. And we're trying to now formalize how you can go from one generation to the other and try to understand how these changes are going to shape the populations over time. That's essentially the goal. So, an important player of that is the person on the left. His name is Punnett, and he was working with Bateson. Bateson was the person that essentially rediscovered Mendel. For a long time, people did not pay attention to Mendel's work. And then he talked to his assistant, actually, that was Punnett. There was a mathematician that started to elaborate some theories about it. His name was Yule. And then there is an American that also worked on this and actually found the solution, and his name is Castle. Usually people do not talk about him, although it should be called the Hardy-Weinberg-Castle equilibrium, but hardly anyone talks about it. So Punnett had talked to Bateson about the issue of how to understand how genes change, gene frequencies, allele frequencies change over time. He talked to Bateson, and then he was playing cricket with Hardy. Hardy was a mathematician, pure mathematician, and Punnett said, okay, I have this problem. We have a gene, there are two alleles. What happens in the next generation? And Hardy was embarrassed to talk about it because he says, this is mathematically so trivial, I don't even know if I want to tell you how it works because it's obvious. But anyway, he obliged and very quickly came up with all the theory behind the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. When you cross different genotypes, you make this kind of stuff, and this is called the Punnett square. I don't know if you ever heard the term Punnett square, but Punnett square, Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium, and so on, that's the same thing. I don't like tattoos, I really don't. So, this is why people call it Hardy-Weinberg-Castle equilibrium. If you are a complete nerd, no one knows this. Usually it's the Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Usually it's HWE. In publications, it is so common that hardly anyone writes it in extensive completely. It's just HWE is Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium. Okay. What I'm going to talk about now is going to be incredibly trivial. And you will say, why does he bother talking about it? Just like Hardy did. And so what is cool is that Hardy-Weinberg equilibrium is absolutely trivial when evolution doesn't happen. When it becomes cool is when evolution happens, and that's what I'll talk about later. So right now, just bear with me and let's go through the motions of explaining how it works. So you have a single locus, which means a single gene. Locus is a region in the genome. It's another word for a gene. And there are two alleles, A1 and A2. I'm not talking now about dominant recessive, it doesn't matter. Right now I'm just going to talk about the fact that there are two alleles, two flavors of the same gene, A1 and A2. And there are three possible genotypes. There are two homozygotes, two homozygous genotypes, A1, A1, A2, A2. I'm going slowly here because I think some people didn't take genetics. And then there is a heterozygote, which is a combination of the two alleles, A1 and A2. So there are three potential genotypes, A1, A1, A2, A2, A1, A2. P and Q are always the letters that are used to refer to the frequency of the alleles. I don't know why, that's just how it is. So P is the frequency of allele 1 in the population, Q is the frequency of A2. Because there are only two of them, two alleles, P plus Q is 1. That's 100% of the frequency is 100% is 1. So P plus Q is 1, P is the frequency of 1, Q is the frequency of 2. So that is the setup of how it works at the very beginning, at the outset. If mating occurs at random, the question that Punnett proposed to Hardy is, what is the frequency of A1 and A2 in the next generation? So the Punnett square, I want to remind you, works like this. You have A1 and A2, these are the gametes, and they are being crossed with another individual. Another individual that is A1, A2. So on this side, you have the male and the female, for example, and these are their gametes. So this is their genotype, A1, A2, A1, A2, the two heterozygotes, and this is what they produce. And so they're going to produce A1, 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 A2, or A1, A2. And then this one is going to be A2, A1, and this one is going to be A2, A2. This is a Punnett square. That is, how do you distribute the alleles when two heterozygotes are mating? So the question is, this is the original population. What happens in the next generation? So, because what we want is, we're interested in microevolution. So what happens in the course of evolution? What happens in the next generation? So what are the probabilities of mating at the gamete level? So you have these four situations, which are these ones. A1 multiplied by A1, the frequency of A1 is P. So it's P multiplied by P, that's P squared. This one is going to be QP, this one is going to be